I want to give you guys some historic examples of leadership in action. The stories I'm going to talk about are people that came from humble beginnings that nobody in this room should have ever heard of. But because they chose to manifest within themselves the classic leadership traits, their names rang throughout history. But again, none of them in this room should have ever heard of these people, okay? They were born at a very, very humble beginnings, less than humble beginnings. Some of them were born as personal property. Just a case in point of how asymmetric leadership doesn't know position, it doesn't know rank. The beautiful thing about it is everybody is free to exercise it. Let's see, let's dust off our history books. She's born an illiterate peasant farm girl. 1429. Anybody recognize this artist's rendition? Very good. Born a poor peasant farm girl, the Hundred Years' War is raging on. England is on the verge of crushing France. She's not born into royalty. Her parents are farmers. She can't even read. Through pure persuasion and perseverance, she gains an audience with King Charles VII. She convinces King Charles VII to allow her to accompany his armed troops on the way to try to break the siege of Orléans. The English have the French under the siege of Orléans, and if they are successful, all of France will fall. It is considered to be the pivotal battle. She convinces his generals to allow her to get a seat at the war council. She accompanies them to the siege of Orléans, and through her motivation, through the details that she gave them, she was allowed to do the planning. The siege is broken. You see, in this artist's rendition, she's allowed to have a suit of armor on, okay? She was allowed to fly her own banner and put on a suit of armor. Back then, in 1429, a woman was not allowed to put on a suit of armor. That was way outside of the realm of possibility. She lived in the world as what is possible. And now, she is the most researched person throughout the medieval age, the most written about person in the medieval age. Now, most of you are going to recognize this picture. Who is it? Audie Murphy. Everybody knows about him. Everybody who ever put on a uniform in office, everybody who didn't, knows about Audie Murphy. But again, none of you should have ever heard about him because of the circumstances that he was born into. Born into a poor sharecropper's family in Texas. His dad abandons the family when he's a boy. Audie Murphy drops out of school in the fifth grade to pick cotton for a dollar a day just to put food on the table and do odd jobs. That is when his formal education ended, fifth grade. 13 or 14 kids in the house. His mom dies. Now he is the man of the house. He's taking care of everybody. Hunting with a rifle, the 22 to put food on the table, picking cotton for a dollar a day and doing odd jobs. The Japanese attack Pearl Harbor. Audie Murphy always wanted to be a soldier. He goes to enlist in the Marines, they turn him down. He goes to the Army, they turn him down. Two reasons. Number one, he's a pipsqueak, he's underweight. He is too small to fight. Number two, he's too young, he's underage. But it's a great opportunity and they need the money and he wants to fight. So he has his older sister, who's good at false documentation, makes an affidavit to get a birth certificate that actually makes him a year and a half older than he really is. He goes home, eats a lot of rabbit, packs on a few more pounds, goes in, raises his right hand, joins the Army. He's with Uncle Sam now. Gets the Congressional Medal of Honor at age 19. And let me refresh you military historians about what he did to get it. He's in charge of a platoon. They destroy a German M10 tank destroyer. The Germans are fighting the back end of the wood line. Audie Murphy sends everybody back in the wood line to triage the wounded, reconsolidate ammunition. He climbs on top of a burning tank destroyer that's in flames, but the 50 cal is still operational. Uses that 50 cal for over an hour to stench off a German advance. Kills over 50 German soldiers from atop of one of their vehicles. Gets shot in the leg, dismounts the tank destroyer, runs back to the wood line, gathers up his guys, motivates them, reconsolidates ammo, and leads a successful counterattack. At age 19, Joan of Arc and Audie Murphy, two people who chose to display the leadership traits that we all know to be good despite their humble beginnings. By the way, Audie Murphy, one of the first voices to cry out to say, hey, our guys need help. Back then, it was known as battle fatigue and shell shock. He suffered from it. A lot of his friends suffered from it too. As you know, he came back from the war. He's starring in movies. He's making music. He uses his voice to call out for help. He goes, hey, there's an issue. A lot of these guys and gals come back and they need help. One of the first voices to call out for help for what we now know as PTSD. Let's do another one. This involves a lot of civilians. What is this picture from? All forms of transportation on or off lower Manhattan were stopped on the events of 9/11. People that work there found out that Manhattan truly is an island. The only way on or off lower Manhattan was by boat on the events of 9/11 on that day. Coast Guard Captain Mike Day, who was on duty that day, notices that party boats, tugboats are self-evacuating people off of lower Manhattan. He says this is the only way to get it done. Keep in mind, they still don't know the totality of this attack. They don't know if more planes are coming. They don't know if there's car bombs out there. They don't know if there's suicide bombers out there. Captain Mike Day gets on the phone, puts out an all call to every vessel in the area. It says, this is U.S. Coast Guard Captain Mike Day. Any and all vessels who are willing to help evacuate people off of Lower Manhattan report to Governor's Island. And every boat on the water came. Party boats, tugboats, ferry boats, personal passenger boats. The largest boat lift in history. How many of you have seen the movie Dunkirk? It was way larger than Dunkirk. On that day, civilians, untrained and without rehearsals, in under 9 hours, evacuated 500,000 civilians. Leadership in action. None of them on that day, that morning when they reported to duty, when they got on their pleasure boats, when they got on their pleasure crafts, none of them thought that history would tap them on the shoulders and ask them, are you ready? But every one of them answered the call. And when they were steering into that thick, black, acrid smoke, they had no idea what they were going into. One of the boat captains said in an interview, because people were jumping in the water and swimming out to him, at first he was tempted to steer away because he thought they were suicide bombers. Because they didn't understand the totality of the attacks at the time. 9/11 boat lift, asymmetric leadership in action. Very few of those people were assigned leadership duties to do that, but they rose to the challenge. One more for you. Who is this? Birth name, Araminta Ross. Her nickname growing up was Minty. Later on, she takes on the code name Moses, was her code name. When I say born into humble beginnings, born worse than that. Born as somebody's personal property. Harriet Tubman, born a slave in Maryland, escapes as a young woman to Philadelphia, successfully escapes, gets to Philadelphia, stops. She says, my mom and dad are still back there. Turns right around, goes back to Maryland, and rescues her mom and her dad, leads them out back to Philadelphia. She gets back to Philadelphia, and she says, well, if I can get them out, I can get others out. And everybody knows what she did then. She joined the Underground Railroad. She made no less than 17 trips herself, right? Leading groups out, sometimes by force. She carried a weapon. A lot of people don't know. Sometimes some of the slaves that she was liberating actually lost their nerve to escape, but they wanted to go back. There were quite a few instances in history where she literally took her pistol out, put it to the head of someone who she was trying to rescue, and said, I'm saving you whether you like it or not. You are not going back to the plantation, okay? But her story doesn't end there. Civil War breaks out. She wants to be a part of it. She gets employed by the Union Army as a cook. Despite all of her skills, her knowledge of the terrain, her knowledge of the human terrain, they only give her a job as a cook, but she is not discouraged. She keeps at it, and she does the absolute best that she can do within her position as a cook. She shows leadership as a cook. She goes from a cook to a battlefield nurse. Then she goes from being a battlefield nurse to being one of the first women during the Civil War to lead an armed expedition. the raid at Combahee Ferry, which happened right up in South Carolina. She was part of the planning, part of the intelligence cell. She was on the boat. She had her own armed expedition during the raid at Combahee Ferry and liberated over 700 slaves. So two times in her life, born as a slave, showed asymmetric leadership from that position. Underground Railroad, led people out, didn't stop there. Civil War breaks out. By that point, she'd already done enough good deeds to last 10 lifetimes. She does not rest. She wants to help out. She goes to the Union Army, and they give her a job as a what? She's Harriet Tubman. They only let her come out as a cook. But through her perseverance, through her passion, through her knowledge, she becomes a battlefield nurse. And she translates that position into being an armed leader of expeditions and raids. Leadership in action. These are all examples of people who none of us in this room should have ever heard of. But because they chose to show leadership from their station in life, their names will ring throughout history. The actions of being a leader are not restricted to a position. Everybody and anybody is free to exercise them if they choose to do so. Personal example, the young man, the young American you see up there smiling and laughing was one of my intelligence advisors we had on the team. Lieutenant Chris Rosebrock, he's a young, fresh-faced lieutenant there. He's a little bit more grizzled now. This picture was taken in 2012. All those men around him are Afghan fighters. They were drawn to him through his magnetic personality and because he always showed leadership traits. Although he was a lieutenant, he was not in a leadership position. He was there just to advise our Afghan intel counterparts on intelligence operations. But he cared about them, and they knew that he cared about them. He went out on all the patrols with us. He shared hardships. He shared danger. He showed leadership in all of his actions. And wherever you would find Chris, you would find a scene like that. A group of Afghans just always around him. They wanted to be within arm's reach of him because of the kind of guy that he was. They felt good around him. One of my personal heroes, the young man on the left who's mean mugging at whoever took this picture, is Jake Williams. He's no longer in the Army. On this day, April 4, 2012, he's the youngest member of that patrol set. He had just recently turned 21. We were doing a counterinsurgency patrol through the city of Maimana. A suicide bomber struck our patrol. Everybody in the patrol set was either killed or trying not to be dead. Jake Williams was the only one who was mobile. He was the only one who could walk. And as you can see, he was full of holes himself. That blood on his leg is his own. He's popped full of holes. I woke up and I'm trying to tourniquet myself off. I see Jake running around. He's putting a tourniquet on the man right there who my friend Matt Castile's working on. That's Nick Rosansky. He's putting a tourniquet on Nick Rosansky. And the Taliban, as they like to do, because they're very crafty, they had a couple of shooters on top of a hilltop, and after the suicide bomber detonated, they started assaulting down the hill to kill any and all survivors. Even with my ears ringing from the detonation, I can hear the bullets coming in. Choop, choop, choop. I can hear them going off. I look up to see who can fight, because I'm useless at that point. And I see Jake Williams grab Nick Rosansky's rifle and his rifle and sprint towards the Taliban with a rifle in each hand to fight him off of us. I saw him running off, and I tried not to think it, but I thought that's probably the last time I'm ever going to see him because he's going by himself. And then in the midst of all that, I thought, how lucky are we as a nation to produce young men like that who just turned 21, and he's going to sacrifice himself to save his brothers. It worked out well for us that day. Jake was successful. All right, we had some other help show up. But he was a PFC, which is a E-nothing, right? These are the guys that use carsmen, that use car sailors target outside of every major military installation. We'll finance E2 and up, right? They're talking about young Jake Williams, just turned 21, okay? Full of holes himself from ball bearings coming off the suicide bomber's vest. Nobody would have faulted him if he would have done what he was trained to do in that instance, which would have been seek cover and patch his own wounds. In fact, he would have been awarded for doing that, for taking care of himself. But he looked around and he realized, this has fallen upon my shoulders. I need to make this happen now. And he assumed control. When my partner Matt Castile shows up, I had been dragged off by Afghan civilians. Matt comes, Lieutenant Colonel Castile comes up. He expects me to come up to him and give him the situational report. But I'm not there, I'm gone. He gets it from Jake Williams, who's already started a little triage center. He's got everything under control. Just turned 21. Right? The average 21-year-old American who hasn't served is still in college. Jake Williams was out saving the world that day, okay? Leadership is an action. He decided to show it that day, in that moment. Was not in his job duty, was not in his job description. He could have simply crawled behind cover and patched his own wounds, which is what most people would have expected him to do, and nobody would have faulted him for it. But he decided to rise to the occasion. Thank you for listening. I'm Dave Allow. This has been FLETC Talks.